All right, so in this video, we're gonna continue to learn Chapman-Kolmogorov equation. But we'll use this time, we'll use more complicated examples and we'll derive something very interesting. So let's see. Example three. Example three is textbook. Example 4.11. So let me still copy down the examples. Right. So it says the balls are successfully distributed among eight urns. So basically, we have eight urns and we have balls. And it says with each ball being equally likely to be put in any of these urns. So let me copy down this setting. So each ball equally likely to be put in any urn. All right. Okay. So now here comes a question. The question asks, what is the probability so of non-empty is three? Okay, is exactly three. So after nine balls. So basically, equals what? Okay, it's basically we have been distributed nine balls to these eight urns, and what is the probability of we have exactly three non-empty urns? So number of non-empty urn being three. All right, so apparently we can solve this problem using classical probability theory or using more classical combinatorial technique. But today we'll try to solve this using the technique of a Markov chain. So to convert this problem to a Markov chain problem, apparently we have to set up. So what is Xm? Okay, so we have one key that is what is Xn? So what does Xn represent? The second one is apparently the state space. Okay. The third one is the most important, and that's transition probability. First is this Xn, and intuitively speaking, we can set. So, for example, we are interested in number of non-empty urn being three after nine balls. So this Xn can be naturally set as number of non-empty urn after m balls being distributed into these eight urns. And apparently the state space is quite simple because we have total. So we have total eight urns. So the state space, because it's a number of non-empty urn. So apparently initially we have eight, I'm sorry, initially we have a zero non-empty urn. So after we put one ball into these eight urns, we have one non-empty urn. So, and later on we may have more. So our state space can apparently be zero, and a 1. But because we totally, okay, have 8 urns, so maximum possible state is 8. All right? So this is our state space is the non-negative integers from 0 to 8. All right. So now here comes the most difficult part. That is a transition probability. So first we'll consider the one-step transition probability. So for example, let's use little letter I to represent our state space. So let's first consider 0 and P0, 0. That is the state given, so it's a probability given xm is 0 and xm plus 1 is 0. All right. So apparently, I mean, first of all, in the context, because we always start our clock when we put the first ball, when we start distributing balls, so this is always something like this, all right? And think about this. This one means number of non-empty urn is 0 at time 0. So this one means number of non-empty urn is still 0 after one ball being distributed. I mean, apparently this is not possible because initially if we have 0 non-empty urn and after we distributed one balls, there must exist one non-empty urn. So this is 0. And let's consider P01. So let me directly write down. This is given x0 is 0 and x1, the probability of x1 being 1. And using the interpretation of above conditional probability, we can apparently get this is probability 1 because if initially we have 0 non-empty urn, after we distribute one ball, we always have one non-empty urn. And and using a similar, so using similar logic, we'll get this is 0 for j is greater than or equal to 2. All right, so now let's continue to move on, and for I is 1. First of all, from I equals 1, which we have one non-empty urn, and it's impossible to have 0 non-empty urn at the next step because we already have some ball in some urn, all right? So this is 0. And let's look at, so now what's getting interesting is what happens when we consider P11, all right? So by definition, this is gonna be, so x sub n is 1, all right? And xn plus 1 is one. Okay, so no matter what happens, again, because for this n, n, first of all, we have to restrict this, n has to be greater than or equal to 1, okay. So first I'm gonna claim that it doesn't matter, it actually doesn't matter what this n is. This transition probability doesn't depend on n. So let's say, let me make this remark here. So xn being 1 means we have one non-empty urn. At time n, and think about this. If we just have one non-empty urn at time n, it means we have seven other urns being empty. So, and next time, if we still have one non-empty urn, at time n plus 1, it means at the next time step, okay, the ball we are gonna distribute is gonna fall into the exact same urn at, so it's gonna fall into the exact same urn where this non-empty urn at time n. So this is the same probability such that the ball is distributed into this very non-empty urn at time n, all right? So because we have non-empty urn, and next time we totally have 8 urns and we have one non-empty, and next time we have to choose this urn out of 8 urns, and it's equally likely to distribute it between these 8 urns, so we have 1/8 of a probability, all right? So, hope you guys are okay with the explanation. And next time, so we're computing P12. So, and using very similar logic, okay, using very similar logic, we'll see that. So this is nothing but, equals 2 and x sub n is 1. Using very similar logic, we'll see that P1j is 0 if j is greater than or equal to 3. So this is because, okay, this 1 means we have one non-empty urn and whichever that n is, and this j means we have j non-empty n. So this is at time n, and this is at m time n plus 1. If j is greater than or equal to 3, because we only distribute one ball at a time, so this one is impossible. Apparently this is 0, so which means this is 1 minus the probability above, which is P11. So this equals 7/8. And now if you guys can generalize this relation, apparently we can, this relation would be, so PI I is I divided by 8, and this one is 1 minus pi. So let me use a comma, I plus 1. Okay, let me add a comma here. So this means we have I non-empty n. At time n, and this we means we have I plus 1 non-empty at time m plus 1. So now we've set up the one-step transition probability. If we look back at the question we're interested to solve, we're interested to solve the number of non-empty n equals 3 after 9 balls, okay, being distributed. It then so initially, when 0 balls are distributed, we have 0 non-empty n. So our initial state is 0, all right, and our end state is 3. So this is P 0 3. Let me still use a comma to be consistent. And because it's after 9 balls, so we've experienced like 9 transition. Okay, so this is essentially, if we have our capital P being our transition probability, one-step transition probability matrix, then this is the desired probability. It means so. This is the 0, 3 entry of the matrix P to the 9th power, where P is our one-step transition probability matrix. And moreover, okay, using Chapman-Kolmogorov equation, we know that this is nothing but we can use this intermediate state. So this is apparently P 0 1 to the first power, which means we use one step from state 0 to state 1, and the multiply is so this we have this 1 as intermediate state, and from state 1 to state 3 and after 8th step. All right, so and apparently this is because this is 1, this is 1, so this probability is 1 we just have derived, and then this equals P13, which is P to the 8th power, then 13 entry. Yet, however, if we look at this matrix P, we'll find that it's first of all, we have a 9 states, all right, which means this P is let me write down this remark. So this is there is a caveat. This original P is a 9 by 9 matrix. Okay. And we want to compute this 9 by 9 matrix, multiply with itself 8 times. All right, so it's a very, I mean, you can use computer, but we have a simpler way to solve this problem. So, and we have to look back at this problem. We have to observe the following fact. So, we have the following observation. That so first I'll give you guys this leap of faith, that is we can treat number of non-empty arms. Being greater than or equal to 4, okay, so this event as a single state. Why we can do that? Because we are only interested in, because the probability of interest is only 4. Number of non-empty being 3. If we think about this, why we can treat this as a single state is once we hit this state at some time n. Okay, so let me write down the statement here. So because once, if number of non-empty okay, so number of non-empty is 4 right here, okay, there is no way, okay, xm plus 1 is less than 4, so which means xm plus 1 is greater than or equal to 4. And this actually implies we're not that interested in those states. And we could treat them as a single state because once xn hit this state, it will stay in this state forever. Let me rewrite. So let me rewrite this statement. That is, if we're given a new state, so A is a state in which xn is greater than or equal to 4. Okay, so, and very interestingly, so we can define a new Markov chain. So we define a new Markov chain, and this new Markov chain is very simply defined. So let's name this W sub n, and we define the following. So we define the following, that is this capital N is the first time, all right, so the first time x sub n is greater than or equal to 4. Basically, it's the first time x sub n is equal to 4. So now we can define w sub n as the following. That is, w sub n is x sub n if n is less than n. And what does this mean is, so if n is less than n, it means number of non-empty is less than or equal to 3, all right? So, and this new Markov chain enters this fixed, or say, so we'll later learn a name for this state, but let's just call it fixed, because once we enter this state, we stay at this state forever. So this is a number of non-empty becomes greater than or equal to 4. It's impossible, probabilistically, it's impossible to go back with less non-empty arms. So now what happens is we have derived the one-step transition probability matrix for x sub n, all right? So now we can write down the transition probability for w sub n. Now how about, so now the question, say how about for w sub n? So now let's add, this is one also for wn, okay? Then we only have to consider four states. That is state 1, state 2, state 3, and lastly is our new introduced state A. So if we write down the probability matrix, so this is state 1, state 2, state 3, and state A. All right. So from state 1, we derived earlier, we have 1/8 of a probability to stay at state 1. And if we choose the 7 rest non-empty urn to put our ball, then we have a 7/8 of a probability that we move into state 2. And the other two, the probability of entering other two states are 0. So from state 2, we cannot go back to state 1. So this probability is 0. And because we have 2 non-empty urn, so we have 2 out of 8 chance to select these 2 non-empty urn and to put our ball in. So next step, we still have 2 non-empty urn. And we also have 6 out of 8 chance to select an empty urn. So we have 3 non-empty urn at next step. And similar, using similar reason, we have 0, 0 here. And we have 3/8. And this is 5/8. And the last one. So if we have reached state A, which means our non-empty urn is greater than or equal to 4, we cannot go back to all previous state. And we'll stay at this state forever. So this is 1. Okay. So this is our probability matrix. So now we let still this probability, one step transition probability matrix as capital P tilde. Okay. It's for P tilde is like, so it's like one step transition probability matrix for Wn, and we'll look at the same we're looking actually at the same probability, that is P13 to the 8th power, which is the original probability of interest, is we have 3 non-empty urn after 9 balls. So keep this in mind. This is the same thing as this. So we're interested in this probability, and we computed using this probability. So then this is the same as P tilde 8, 1, 3. Okay, and P tilde is a 4x4 matrix. And even more interestingly, this is, this is a upper diagonal matrix, and its power is not so hard to be computed. So, you guys can compute this. So the textbook uses the following trick. The textbook first compute, we raise the matrix to the 4th power, and then we take square. Okay, so the answer is 0.00756. So So here I'll just ask you guys to refer to the textbook. So next video we'll learn, and next video is optional, so we'll learn some theoretical derivation of how do we translate our old Markov chain to a new one if we are interested in the probability of entering a set of states.